Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this live event, lesson 58 of the Java Fundamentals stream, and we continue our discussion with the last subject of the multi-threaded chapter, which is concurrent collections. So today we will end this chapter with the concurrent collections subject, and next time we'll be able to move on. If you're watching the event live, don't forget that we have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions in the live chat directly. If you're not watching the event live, if you see the recording, then you can still ask questions in the comment section, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter and we can discuss there as well. So with that being said, let's just step into the first exercise. Actually, exercise is too much for today's lesson, because as you will see, I will show you some lines of code, but we'll basically discuss more theoretically about the concurrent collections. But I will share you my screen so that you can see the classes and what I refer to. And the whole idea is that the concurrent collections, they are collections that basically they rely on the same interfaces and the same logic that we have already discussed in one of the previous lessons. So when we discuss now about the concurrent collections, which still are lists, maps, queues, sets, and decks, we won't retake the functionality itself of what a list is, what a set is, what a map is, and so on and so forth. So I will start today by considering that you already know these things, and I will build on what I consider you already know and you have learned from one of the previous lessons of this stream. Because remember, in one of the previous lessons of this stream, we discussed about collections in general. So in case you don't know yet what collections are and how do they work, my advice for you is to first watch the video or the videos, because I think there are multiple videos, multiple lessons on which we dissected in detail the collections framework in Java. And after that, watch this video, because of course you will need to already know how collections work in Java before trying to understand the concurrent collections. And in this lesson, we will explicitly focus on which are the implementations you need to know of concurrent collections. And how do they work? Basically, what's different? We can understand in general that they are designed to be used on multiple threads and they are synchronized somehow. But of course, they are multiple implementations, and they, from one perspective or another, they are different. So we have to discuss about these differences, about which kinds of questions you might encounter in your OCP exam in case one of your objectives is to obtain that certification. And of course, which are cases in which you use one or another of these implementations in a real world example, in a real world scenario. So there are a lot of things we need to discuss. So we start from the conclusion that they are normal collections, and they are made, they are designed to be used on in multi-thread architectures. But we need to discuss a lot of things about how do they work, and all these things will help you in both your OCP exam, in case that's one of your objectives, as well as real world scenarios implementations. So let's start with the first. Yeah, there's not necessarily an order in which we can take them. I will just take them in a random order I have it in mind now, and I start with the concurrent map. So if you take a look, you will see that you have an interface named concurrent map, and that's basically one of the interfaces that extend the normal contracts, the usual contracts you are already used to from the collections framework. And of course, the concurrent map, it basically implements a map. So already a question: can we implement database data structure by using a hash map? I'm not sure what that, you have to extend that question, because I don't know what a database data structure, what do you mean by a database data structure? You want to simulate a database using a hash map, for an example? Yes, you can do that, of course, depending on if you access it with multiple threads or not, you will need to use a concurrent implementation. But I'm not sure if that's your question precisely, because I'm not sure if I understood correctly what a database data structure is for you. So if that's not your question, then please rephrase it so I can understand it better. But I hope that at least answers a bit of your question. I was saying that we have the concurrent map, which is one of the contracts extending the map contract, and then you have the concurrent hash map as an implementation of the concurrent map. So I don't know, we can use any generic types here, it's irrelevant. You can just say string and integer, or integer and string here. It's the same generic types that you already know maps use for the key and the value. The rules are the same. The keys are unique. It's basically a normal map. So take it as a normal map. That's why I said I won't now dissect again how a map works or how a list works or how a set works, because we've already done that. I want you to focus on what these concurrent maps has above the normal implementation of a map. So this concurrent map is the contract representing maps which are created to be used in multi-threaded environments. So I can say M1, and then what we are most interested of is which are the implementations of these kinds of collections that are made to be used in concurrency environments. And one of them is the concurrent hash map. And the concurrent hash map is the first implementation we discussed, but you basically, it's a very, very simple implementation of a synchronized hash map. The only thing you need to know about it is just like a hash map, but it's synchronized so that you can use it in multi-threaded environments. Because if you try to use a hash map in a multi-threaded environment and you don't do the synchronization yourself with one of the means you've learned in the previous lessons, like the synchronized keyword or by using any of the blocking objects, if you don't do that yourself, then it won't work. And I think in one of the first lessons in which we have discussed threads, we have used an array list, which the array list is of course a list implementation, but it's again an implementation that is not concurrent. And I have used it at that moment explicitly to show you why you need to synchronize in some cases your block of codes, because in some cases you have race conditions, and in those cases you have to take care of the objects that are not made to be used in such environments. So in case of a concurrent hash map, it's only a map implementation that you can assume you can directly use in a multi-threaded environment without needing to take yourself the responsibility of synchronizing it. So in this case, you won't need, you can use it from multiple simultaneous executing threads without needing yourself to use the synchronized keyword or a blocking object or any other means to implement the synchronization. Just use the map, and this implementation synchronizes for you the request to its modifications as well as the read operations. So you don't need to do that yourself, and that's pretty easy. So this is the first implementation and the simplest. You just use concurrent hash map whenever you need a map implementation that you want to use from multiple threads which are concurrent, which are creating a race condition scenario. And then we have the alternative, because this one is an equivalent of HashMap, with the difference, of course, that's concurrent, that's an implementation that allows you to use it from multiple executing simultaneous threads without doing the synchronization yourself. But same as HashMap, the concurrent HashMap is not ordered, is not sorted, which means that you have the keys and the key pairs, actually the key value pairs, they are in an order which is inside managed by the map, on those buckets of hashes, same as HashMap is doing, which means that you can't rely on a specific order. If you add some keys and values in a specific order, when you parse the structure, you won't necessarily have the same order. It might be, but it's not mandatory the same order. So that's why we don't rely on an order, and we can't say the elements are either sorted somehow in a hash map, and same we can say about a concurrent hash map. But in case you want to have an implementation of a concurrent map that also that also sorts the elements, so an equivalent to the tree map, I could say in this case, because you remember tree map was an implementation, a non-concurrent implementation of map, but that was sorting actually the values in this case by the keys in a specific order that was either the natural order of the objects given by the comparable interface implemented as it was implemented by the object, or by a comparator that you could have externally supplied to the instance of the collection. In this case, when you have something with skip list, so when you have any kind of implementation, there are two implementations, a map and a set here, with a skip list inside. And here I try to actually give you a way to remember them easier, because in case you need to your objective is to take that OCP certification, so you have to attend and pass the exam, then one of the things you'll need to do is to remember these implementations and the differences between them, and as well which are their characteristics. So you need a easy way to remember this, and the easiest way is remember that when you see a skip list inside the name, that kind of implementation sorts the values. So it's an implementation, a concurrent implementation that sorts the values. So this one, the concurrent skip list map, is, I will just put it like this for the moment. Okay, this one is an implementation equivalent with tree map, of course, in terms of how it works. But it's like a tree map that is also made concurrent, because remember, the tree map implementation is not a concurrent implementation, so you cannot use it as is from multiple concurrent threads, because of course you'll get a lot of errors and it won't work, as we again have seen in one of the examples in one of the previous lessons, where I have tried to show you why synchronization is important, and I used an array list. Same as that array list, you would have a problem if you are using a hash map or a tree map. So if you want to use a map, you either use a hash map or a tree map and you do the synchronization yourself, or you use a concurrent implementation. If you want a normal, like a hash map, where you don't have an order or a sorting, but the speed of accessing the elements is very fast, then use a concurrent hash map. If you need to have sorted values, like in a tree map, then you use a concurrent skip list map. And this concurrent skip list map, remember, the skip list inside is the easiest way for you to remember when you see this name with a skip list inside in a certification exam question, then remember this means sorted. So remember, try to assign this with being sorted. If you go in the class itself, you can see what we want to see, the interfaces that the class is implementing. Hopefully I will see them somewhere where the class is declared. Let me search for it. So class something, oh my god, it's a big class. Okay, so this is it. You see, this implements actually the concurrent navigable map, and this is the contract that is the equivalent of the navigable map contract we discussed about, which in terms itself, it extends the concurrent map, which is the contract we have discussed here. So again, this is why I could have actually either written something like this, say integer and string, so it's also concurrent map. So you can write something like this. Or if you want to remember as well that this is a concurrent navigable map, so you can say concurrent navigable map, and as well you can assign this instance into this variable m3, which is of type concurrent navigable map because of the polymorphism. So you can do that. So let me leave them like this for you, because when you'll study, then you'll find these examples on my GitHub as always, and you might want to remember what we have discussed. So important is for you to remember the contracts and the implementations and the differences among them. And of course, we have the set implementation, the sorted set implementation, which is the concurrent skip list set. So concurrent skip list set. So this is an implementation of a set equivalent with what we knew as being a tree set, but instead of being non-concurrent, as the tree set is, the concurrent skip list set not only sorts the values same as the tree set does, but it also makes sure that it implements a concurrent implementation, which enables you use this from multiple threads. And same as in the case of the map, you see that you have here the implementation is a navigable set directly, but yes. For the sets, we don't have a concurrent. I just remember this. So it directly implements the navigable set. I'm not sure precisely why they didn't actually create a concurrent contract for the sets as well, because I had this question and I always have it anytime I start to recap these objects. But in case of the set, you need to use the navigable set in case you want to, for example, return this from a method. So you don't have, like in case of the map, an explicit way of saying that I want something that needs to be concurrent. For the map, you have that. You have the concurrent map contract. But for the set, you don't have such an interface that you can use to enforce the fact that you want a concurrent implementation. Again, don't know why this was the way in which they implemented the structure. So remember, skip list means sorted, and you have two implementations, one of a map and one of a set. So these are the three first important implementations of concurrent collections you need to know. So one of them, the concurrent hash map, and then the two implementations, one for a map and the other one for a set. Sorry, here it is, for the case of the collections that are sorted. Maybe it's good to actually say sorted here, just to make sure that everybody knows why I've written tree set and tree map near them. Sorted. Okay, so this is not sorted. And now we have, and I will create, just to make the your learning easier afterwards, I would like to separate them into examples. So I would create for the next collections that we discuss a different class. So let me create an example too. So say public static void main, and then we have the queue and the deck, concurrent linked queue and concurrent linked deck, are an implementation of a queue and an implementation of a deck. Again, we don't have some specific contracts for this, if I remember correctly. So it's still directly extending queue and respectively the other one directly extending deck, like in the case of the set. So the map seems to have been the only one lucky to have its own concurrent map contract. And you can write something like this, of course, say concurrent, queue of integer, you can assign this concurrent linked queue implementation. And same, we have the possibility to have a deck. So we have a deck of integer, and this is the D, and you have a concurrent linked deck, which is the implementation for a concurrent deck again, which the same as the previous map and list that we discussed. Of course, If somebody asks you if these are ordered, they are ordered. And they are of course ordered because any queue and any stack has a specific order, and you know that, the queue and the deck, we have learned to use these to implement stacks and decks, so they have a specific order in which we keep the, values. Otherwise you couldn't use this, these collections to implement first in first out and last in first out principles. I'm not sure precisely why in case of the OCP exam we still find these questions about why and which are of the collections are ordered, because they are pretty, it's pretty easy to, know which, of these are ordered. But be careful, they are not sorted. So ordered but not sorted. Ordered means that you have the elements in a known order. That known order can be defined by the way in which you add the values to the collection. But sorted means that you have a rule that is linked strictly to the elements themselves. And this, rule is given either via the comparable interface, either via a comparator. In case of the queue and the deck, the concurrent link queue and deck are examples like any other queue and deck of ordered collections, but they are not sorted. Okay. Again, I tell you this because just because you sometimes find these details asked in the OCP exam questions. And then two collections that are basically my favorites, and I will create a separate example three: the copy and write array list and the copy and write array set, which are a little bit different. So because they are a little bit different, I want to actually treat them separately. So copy on write array list, and that's my list, and you have the copy on write array set. And these are really interesting implementations because they don't actually imply the concurrency on the operations themselves. They don't synchronize the operations. They basically synchronize, they work by creating for any operation that is a change in the collection, they create a new instance. So that creation of the new instance is synchronized. And then when you work with adding values or removing values or changing references inside the collection, you basically work on a copy of that collection. So any kind of mutating operation on this kind of a collection creates a new instance of the collection which copies all the values again. So that's why this, implementation is really interesting. It's not like in the case of all the others in example 1 and 2 that we discussed. All the others, they are simply synchronizing the operations. So you have only one collection, and that collection is basically synchronizing the operations on itself, so that when you use it from different threads, the operations are synchronized, and this way we avoid the race condition. Pretty easy. So a concurrent hash map, a concurrent skip list map, a concurrent skip list set, these both implementations of concurrent queues and decks, they simply synchronize the operations. But the copy and write array list and the copy and write array set, both these implementations, they don't directly synchronize the operations. They, any kind of change, that is any mutating operation, any mutating operation, which is add, change reference in collection, or of course remove, these three, which represents the mutating operations on collections, they create for any element for which any operation you do, they create a new instance of that collection, copy all the values, and then do the operation on the copy of the collection. So it's a different fashion of synchronizing it. By this, it basically solves concurrency. So it's a concurrent implementation because any thread will basically work on that specific copy of new copy on which that is created for that operation. But you have to be very careful with these implementations, because if you have a lot of mutating operations, this might fill up your memory pretty fast, and you can even get an out of memory error in some cases if your threads do a lot of operations. For any operation, it will basically copy the collection and recopy it. And of course, theoretically, they will be the instances behind that are not used anymore. They will be garbage collected at some point. But if you have too many threads and they do a lot of mutating operations, then you might actually get to fill up the memory before the garbage collector will be able to collect the instances of collection that are not needed anymore. So you have to be very careful. We use these kinds of implementation, and that's something you need to know for both real world scenarios as well as for your OCP exam. These implementations, the copy and write array list and the copy and write array set, you use only when you have many more read operations than write operations. And that's because when you have only read operations, it will merely act like as a non-synchronized collection. So the access to the element will be fast. But if you have a lot of mutating operations, then you have a problem, because instead of helping you with the access, it will basically fill up your memory. And even though, say, you won't have a problem with the memory, say you don't have that many mutating operations to just get you to an out of memory, or you have a lot of memory, still it's a problem, because you will force the garbage collector act on the memory more often, and the garbage collector itself is a thread that consumes resources. So you won't gain any benefit by using this kind of a collection if you have a lot of mutating operations, because now you will get the memory filled and you will have a garbage collector that will be continuously running, trying to clear the memory that this collection produces for any mutating operation. So you use this kind of collection only if you have many more read operations on the collection than write operations. If you do have that, you have a multi-threaded architecture with a lot of reading operations and very, very few write operations, and for write operations I mean mutating operation, add, change the reference, or remove, then do use this kind of a collection, because it's better for the access, for the access to the element. But in case you suspect you'll have more changes in the collection, then avoid using this to save your processing power and memory, so resources in general. So that's when you use this. And again, remember this both for real world scenarios is important, as well as for your OCP exam, because I've actually seen at some point an implementation where the developers used a copy and write array list or array set. I don't remember clearly which one of these was, but it was used in an environment where actually there were a lot of changes. And when we have changed that implementation and we have used another fashion that I will show you today in this lesson, using basically the one of the synchronized methods of the collections class that I will show you immediately, we have seen immediately an enhancement in the performance of the application. So you could actually measure, it was using the copy on write array set or list, there was that bad that you could actually measure, you could actually feel without needing to have specific proper tools, profilers or so on. You could see that the application is slower than when we have used another kind of concurrent implementation. And the reason was because there were a lot of changes. The developers used this collection without actually understanding it, and the garbage collector was actually so high in trying to eliminate the unneeded instances of the collections that the processor was spiked in some cases up to 100%. So it actually was a pretty bad implementation, and the solution for this was only to actually change the copy on write array list or set to another synchronized collection, which I will show you immediately in this lesson. So keep in mind, this is important. Knowing how this works is important. Now, the last direct implementations of concurrent collections that you need to know are the blocking concurrent collections. And again, to make it easier for you to focus on them afterwards, I will create an example for class and I will write them here. So the blocking queue and the blocking deck, which you see, we have some defined interfaces for this. We have a blocking queue and the blocking deck implementation. So this is a queue, no, a deck, sorry, D1, say. So new, and you have the linked blocking deck, and then you have a blocking queue, and that's a linked blocking queue, sorry. Okay, so these two implementations, again, they are pretty simple. And you simply, in terms of how they work, you can take them as the ones we have discussed in example 2, where we have already discussed about a concurrent link queue and the concurrent linked deck. So you see, we have now again another deck implementation and another queue implementation. And these two are also concurrent collection implementations. So I guess you can you already feel that there should be a difference between these implementations in example 4 and the implementations we have already discussed in example 2, where the difference is a quite small one. When you use the blocking queue and or the blocking deck, of course, we have a queue or a deck, and the important feature, the important capability that comes with this implementation, it is that it allows you on the operations to also specify a timeout. So when you go here and you try to add you try to add a value or maybe to it's at the end of the deck, or it's at the beginning of the deck with a push, for example. You see here we have a push as well. So you also always have the possibility to do this by specifying a timeout. Of course, we also inherit the normal methods that are coming from the normal deck or queue contract, because that one is extended. So if you take a look inside the blocking deck, you see that it's basically extending deck as well. So that's why you see that we have also the methods that don't have a timeout. But the feature, the capability that comes with this is that it enables you to also specify a timeout on the method. So you can use this feature, and usually if you decide to use a linked blocking queue or a linked blocking deck, you use it for this capability. Otherwise, it doesn't really make sense to use it. And this timeout, as you might already imagine, is just a period of time that the collection waits when an operation is triggered for that operation to end. So if I call offer first and I say offer number 4, which means add integer 4 to the deck. Offer first, so I add it at the beginning. That doesn't matter now. And I say 1 time unit seconds. That actually means that I have to my deck has to be able to add that element within a second. And if it doesn't add it within a second, then it will throw a timeout exception. So this way, we avoid situations where we get blocked. So we avoid deadlocks created by the collection. when two threads, say for some reason, they get blocked, and one of them calls offer first, and because of some condition that was wrongly specified by the developer, the offer first cannot add, remains blocked in adding because of another thread, then in this case it only waits for the amount of time you have specified here. In my case, 1 second, so you can say whatever you want here, 1 minute, 5 minutes, whatever you'd like, but the important thing is it only waits for at most this time, and if it reaches this time, then it throws an exception, and this is really, really good. So I do advise you to actually use this implementation rather than the one in example 2 in real world scenarios. So of course, for the OCP exam, you need to know both of the implementations, but if you are into implementing a concurrent queue or a concurrent deck in a real world scenario, then I would choose first the blocking queue or the blocking deck instead of the normal concurrent queue or deck, because it's always better to avoid your system or your application getting stuck. We use a principle that I might have already told you in one of the previous lessons, that it's named fail fast. You better have a timeout and leave your application, throw an exception and fail, rather than remain stuck forever in a specific case. And for example, in implementations such as a pool of connections to a database, and I know if some of you, because we are in the Java Fundamentals stream now, and some of you might not be aware of what a database connection pool is, don't worry, we'll discuss anyway in one of the next lessons about JDBC, and there I will detail a little bit more on what a data source is and what a connection pool is. But for those of you who are already aware of that, when you have a pool of connections to a database and you remain without connections, when grabbing a connection, if you don't have connections and for some reason you won't actually have any more connections because of an error that was produced, you'd better have a timeout and have your connection pool crash, because there are no more connections to be borrowed after a specific timeout, rather than wait forever, rather than block the requester and make the requester wait forever for that connection, because this way it's easier for the developer. A problem is anyway, but it's easier for the developer to find the problem and solve the problem if they see a timeout exception, rather than if they see that the application is stuck but they don't know where, and then they have to profile it, and then they have to do thread dumps and analyze the thread dumps and see where's the problem, and that can take a lot of time. So it's much better to avoid deadlocks on collections and use the timeouts whenever you can. Now, you might have seen that while I was discussing, I have observed as well that you have here compilation error, and I hope that you already guess why we have a compilation error here, and that's because, of course, we have a checked exception that you need to treat. So whenever you use one of these methods of blocking a collection, you also need to treat that very well-known interrupt exception, which you have seen from the very beginning of our multi-threaded chapter. Remember, this interrupted exception is the checked exception thrown when a thread is interrupted while it's in the blocked state. And I have told you at that time, and maybe in some other lessons as well, that any kind of method that blocks a thread throws also interrupted exception. You have only one exception for this that you need to remember for your OCP exam, is the lock method of the read-write-lock object. So when we have used the read-write-lock and the reentrant read-write-lock implementation, one of the previous lessons, you have seen maybe that I didn't need to treat interrupted exception. That's an exception. All the methods that block an object, wait, join, sleep, for the semaphore, the acquire method, for the cyclic barrier, the acquire method, all these methods that block a thread, they also throw interrupted exception. When you are implementing it in a real world scenario, it's easy to see because you have seen the IntelliJ, the IDE shows you precisely that it's a problem there. But be very careful when this appears in one of your OCP exam questions, because there will be no one telling you there that you should treat the interrupted exception. And I have seen questions where kind of methods that are throwing interrupted exception didn't have a try catch or a throws clause. And then students were trying to actually debug the method, were losing a lot of time trying to see what the code does, why it was actually a compilation error from the very beginning. So always take a look when you see any kind of method, you know that it blocks a thread, take a look and make sure that it throws or catches the interrupted exception. Otherwise, it's a compilation problem from the very beginning. So this is the characteristic of a blocking collection, which we have here is the blocking queue and the blocking deck. And the very last thing I'd like to discuss with you in terms of concurrent collections is the synchronized methods from the collections class. Again, very important subject for both real-world implementations for multi-thread architectures as well as your OCP 11 exam. So example 5 and the last one for today. And I want to make you aware of the collections synchronized methods. These are all the collections synchronized methods. So you know that the collections class is an utilitary class where you find a lot of operations on collections. I have already told you about the collections as well as the arrays classes some time ago when we discussed collections. Now it's very probable that at that time we didn't discuss about these synchronized methods, because you couldn't have at that time understand them as long as we didn't discuss the thread related stuff we've done already. So you see here we have plenty of methods whose names start with the synchronized word: synchronized collection, synchronized list, synchronized map, and so on and so forth. So all these synchronized collections methods, what they do, they take as a parameter a collection that is a non-concurrent one, and it returns an instance of that collection that is synchronized, so that you can use on multiple threads. It's not necessarily that you will have one of the implementations that we have seen already in one of the previous four examples. So I don't want you to understand that it will be necessarily one of these. There are cases in which you see here that you get back what you get back is an instance, but you get it using the contract. So you only know it's a collection or a list or a map. You don't know precisely what implementation is there. So don't make the mistake of trying to cast this instance to one of the collections that I have told you already. Just use it as is, because in some cases it's actually even an inner class that's used for decorating and synchronizing the collection you provided. And whenever you use one of these methods, you just use it as is. You provide the instance of the collection as a parameter, you get back still as a contract the instance of the collection, and you use it as a synchronized collection. But never try to cast it to a concurrent collection. So use it as is. When should you use one of these? So for example, let's say I have a synchronized map, okay? So I want a synchronized map, and I have a map already. That's a map of integer and integer, M1, and it's a hash map, which means that it isn't synchronized. because hash map is not concurrent. And then I provide it here. And then what I get from the synchronized map is also a map, but I know that this map, it provides me a synchronized collection. Okay, so why should I use this approach and not directly use concurrent hash map? And the answer is pretty simple. Well, you do actually use concurrent hash map, and you are advised to use concurrent hash map if you know from the very beginning that the collection will be used on multiple threads. So if from the very beginning your collection is designed to be used on a multi-thread architecture, that instance, you know for sure it will be used in a multi-thread architecture, then the advice is to directly use one of the classes that we have discussed here, example 1 to 4. Depending on what's the collection you need, use one of these classes we have discussed here. If you, however, don't know from the very beginning that a specific collection is will be used in a multi-threaded architecture, and when I say collection, I refer to the instance, of course, of a specific collection, and it just in somehow in the class design of your architecture, in some specific situations, it just happened that that instance might be used by multiple threads, but you don't know for sure, then of course what you do is create your collection as a non-concurrent one, and you prefer to have it non-concurrent, because if it's not used as a concurrent collection in all the cases, then it doesn't make sense to add all the time that's spent for the synchronization to your execution, just because at some point it might be used by multiple threads. So you either know that it will be used by multiple threads, and then you make it from the very beginning concurrent hash map, or whatever your collection is, one of the concurrent implementations we discussed, or you make it a normal non-concurrent collection, and only there in that block of code where you need to use it on multiple threads and where it might happen to be used, but you are not sure, you use a collections synchronized method to transform, to take an instance of a synchronized concurrent collection out of a non-synchronized one. And by using this approach, you make sure that you actually use the synchronized implementation only where it's needed and only if it is needed. And that's precisely what you need to do, because you don't want to overload your application with applying a synchronization layer above something that will never be used on multiple threads simultaneously. So you don't want to implement something that will never be used. You want to make sure as much as possible, and that's a rule of thumb in development in general, in terms of performance, maintainability, whatever you want, is that you need to always use only what you need to use. You don't just create a collection as a concurrent implementation because it might be used as a concurrent implementation. You create it as a concurrent implementation only if it's really sure that you will use it as a concurrent implementation. If not, you create it as a non-concurrent one and avoid the synchronization layer above. That would be bad for your performance, as well as maybe maintainability as well of the application. And you make it only synchronized where you need to be synchronized. Thank you also for attending the lessons. I see that again a lot of you have joined, which is pretty nice to see from this side. And hopefully with this I have made clear also the aspect of concurrent collections, which was the plan for today. And I can see I've finished the, I want to call it the fundamentals of threads. And you've seen this fundamentals of threads, were actually, it's a subject that we have discussed in, I don't remember precisely how many, but I think there were about 5 or 6 lessons at least, maybe even more. So it's a fundamentals of threads, but we have actually discussed a lot of what thread-related architectures mean. And that's because threads in general are complicated. So if you now, when you actually try to use all this, you'll find out that with time and experience, you find a lot of things and details you need to take them into consideration. Some of them and most of them are very, very difficult to just demonstrate in examples, and that's why you don't see me creating examples with some of them, because you need a whole architecture to prove some things, and sometimes very difficult to reproduce. But with what you have now, I'm pretty sure you have a getting started for any kind of multi-threaded implementation you might need to do. And also for your OCP exam. So everything you need, hopefully, for your OCP 8 or 11 exam, you can take any of these. This is for today, and hope to see you next week for our next lesson in the Java Fundamentals stream. And not only, thank you very much for attending this.